Hey everyone, how's it going? I am Zerikon and I am back once again. Before I begin, I want to let you all know that I now have a Twitter account. You can see my thoughts or opinions on various geeky slash nerdy topics that I come across, and I may also give a heads up to any videos that I make. I'll try not to spam your feed though. And with that out of the way, let's jump right into today's topic. So a while back, I made a video about my dive into PC gaming, and it later sparked a question within me. What's the point of consoles in this day and age compared to PC? At the time, I thought there were reasons as to why they should exist, and after time has passed, I've come to realize that they really have no reason to exist. Now, before you pull out your torches and pitchforks, I ask that you grant me the chance to explain my reasoning. The first topic is probably going to be familiar for most of you, and I don't want to walk into this, but I figured I should just get out of the way. Performance. Games can and will run better on a PC than on their console counterparts. Heck, Breath of the Wild can run on Simu, a Wii U emulator, runs better than Breath of the Wild on the Switch. Frame rates, graphic fidelity, and resolution are better and more consistent on the PC. In order for console games to look good, the frame rates had to be gimped. I'm talking about back in like the 90s. I mean, 60 frames per second used to be consistent back then, but with the jump to 3D games, 60 FPS started to become rare enough to actually become a selling feature. Like nowadays, you know, a game will try to sell you on 60 frames per second when it used to be a given. The 30 and below FPS has been described as giving a cinematic experience, quote unquote. And while I personally am not capable of differentiating between 30, 60 FPS unless, you know, shown, I would not complain about playing in 60 FPS or a locked 30 without dips. The next thing about the consoles go hand in hand with performance, and that is customization. You have your settings locked on console. Granted, there is the PS4 Pro Boost mode and the resolution slash performance mode in Fire Emblem Warriors. But even with these features, your ability to modify the settings is limited. On PC, you can modify many aspects of the game, including resolution, textures, water reflection, shadows, anti-aliasing, and more. When I first started Batman Arkham Asylum on my PC, most of my settings were automatically set to high, very high, just because of it was following the graphics card. However, this made the frame rates abysmal, and all it took to raise and stabilize them was to go and lower the shadows and texture settings. This kind of thing grants freedom to the gamers and allows the gamer to get the experience they desire, whether it be resolution over frame rate or frame rate over graphics, etc., etc. They can fully customize it. The next feature is online services, and this is a bit of a doozy. The Xbox Game Pass is a neat service that allows you to have a Netflix-esque experience, but with games. However, that is the only good thing that comes from console services. This will probably be the third time mentioning this, but I don't care. Console online services are a scam. You have to pay to play online, and in the case of Nintendo, you're paying for peer-to-peer servers. Servers that you already own and use. PSN free games? What a joke. They're only free when you buy the online service. You aren't gonna get them if you don't pay. Also, when you stop paying for them, you lose those games. And what happens when the servers get shut down? You lose those games. Forever. Sony also raised the price of PSN, and recently, gamers found out that the online service was down. They paid $60 a year to have that happen to them. Unbelievable. And this goes to show you how wrong console online is. On PC, the online is free, and yet, gamers can get discounted games and even free games for free, and you get to keep them. I got For Honor on free for Steam, and I didn't pay a dime in order to get it. Heck, I received 5 other games for free without paying anything prior as part of a service. There are also special Steam sales that are heavenly and addicting. I bought 9 games during the summer sale for just under $20, and that's including AAA titles. The discounts that consoles have don't hold a candle to Steam sales. There is one thing that consoles have that give them an advantage over PC, and that is the ability to share games. If you have a game and want to lend it to a friend, it's as easy as handing it to them. And heck, you can even do it digitally with the game share on PS4. I'm not sure about the other... Well, I definitely know that Nintendo doesn't have that thing. I don't know if Xbox has that or not, but you can do that with PS4. With PC, that sort of thing isn't the case. The best thing you could do is gift a friend a game, Not a gift to friend. The best thing you can do is like giving your friend your Steam info, and then they download the game on their computer. But I wouldn't necessarily recommend this. That's not really something that I would think is best. Now, the next point is pricing. So, the average cost of consoles at launch this gem seems to be around $400, more or less. I mean, I know it can fluctuate. I know that some games, that some consoles might be a bit higher or lower, but that's just the general average. This is something that, at face value, seems like a good price, but let's take into consideration certain details. You are getting a closed system with no ability to be upgraded or customized. If you want to buy the mid-gen upgrade, that is another $400, and again, that's just an average. I know that the Xbox One X costs more than that, but I'm just saying, putting that as an average. For a 1.5 version of the same console you bought previously. And not to mention the cost of the annual online services. Now, take the PC, for example. You are buying an open platform that can be upgraded as you see fit. It can also be built around a budget. If you can only spend $500, that's okay. You can build a decent PC that can be upgraded later on and provide a greater experience without having to buy a new system entirely. There's the myth that you need to spend thousands of dollars to get a good PC, and that isn't true. Linus Tech Tips provides you videos and proves that you can get a good PC for less than $700. Heck, there's a PC that I have my eyes on that is $629 and is more capable of outclassing an Xbox One X. Another note that should be considered with the cost are the features that come with the platforms. Consoles are limited to gaming with some media features and online browsing. PC allows gaming, photo, music, video editing, multiple web browsers, perfect for writers, media features, and more. This makes up for the price gap between consoles and PC. And also, there are also other features that you can do as well. Input options are something that that consoles lack. My friend likes the Xbox controller, but has the PS4 as his primary system. He went and imported a third-party PS4 controller that was similar to an Xbox controller, which cost him over $150. While I can understand why controllers aren't going to be compatible with other consoles, and to be honest, I actually don't blame them for this, this is what gives PC an edge. You can use mouse and keyboard, controller, joystick, steering wheel, whatever you want. When my friends and I play Stardew Valley, one plays with a mouse keyboard, one plays with a PS4 controller, and I play with a Switch Pro controller. Heck, even games that don't support controllers can be worked around with mods and button mapping. I played, what game was it? I can't remember what game it was I was playing. I think it was Unturned. It's a mouse and keyboard controller only, but just by remapping some buttons with the Steam, I can use my controller to play the game. And lastly, and this is perhaps the most condemning of arguments, are games. There's no reason why console games can't work on PC, but there are reasons why PC games can't come to console. Lack of power and lack of proper controls are the main ones. Exclusives are really the only thing that give consoles viability, and that is the greatest pro that goes to them. If you were to strip those away, consoles would be bare-bones weak PCs with limits and, you know, paywalls for online and stuff like that. Microsoft has seen this and has moved some of their exclusives from Xbox to PC. This enables them to have a win-win situation, whether the game is bought on console or PC. Sony has put PS Now on PC, and while this is a streaming service and not them actually providing the games, it gives Sony more revenue. And Nintendo actually should put their classic games up on PC. People will be and are willing to buy them on that platform, and they should also offer better performance features because of that. And with that being said, there is one thing that actually gives them an edge with their hardware, at least. With the Wii system and beyond, Nintendo's made games that you can't play outside of their systems because you actually need the hardware in order to play them. They make their games while keeping in mind the features of the console. Wii games, I mean, of course there are going to be exceptions, but Wii games are going to need a Wii remote. DS games will require a second touchscreen. Certain Switch games require the IR sensor and HD rumble. This gives Nintendo a reason to not go full third party, as they make games that complement the hardware ideas. They like to make things go hand in hand, so they're as much of a hardware company as they are a software company. Still, GameCube era and earlier would boost revenue if brought to PC. Do it, Ninty. With that being said, however, I come to the closing. Consoles may be around now, but who's to say they won't disappear within a few console generations? In order to stay relevant, they need to do something besides boost their power and having exclusives. They need to have special features and innovation to stand apart. Otherwise, they're no different than PCs. And that is it. So let me know your thoughts below. I can already smell the hate, but I hope there will be at least one good conversation. And so everyone, until next time, I am Zerikon signing off. Have a good one.